So let me just continue. So one, again, welcoming everybody to the summit. We've got a power-packed summit along with, of course, we've got Dr. Sharon Noble, we've got Paige Palmer, and we've got Dr. Todd Cameron. And these guys are rock stars in their own arena of work and expertise. So we're so excited to hear from them. And really, this is a time where we're starting to work on not only the mental side, the emotional side, and the physical side with everything that's going on around us. So look, we've come through with some, yes, now he's asking. I'm being asked if I want the slides up. So let's throw those slides up. Russ, let's get going on those. All right, so with that, as you can see, we've got North Star title. Guys, many of you have been on this journey with us. I first and foremost want to thank, of course, all the different title companies, escrow companies that have been helping us for many, many years. It has always been an expectation that I can tell you that we would have title and escrow, we would have mortgage, of course, that would be aligned with our real estate company. The thing that I'm most appreciative of is some of my dearest and closest friends are in the industry and still with living a life of abundance with so much business, so much opportunity that's out there. You know, look, I golf and associate and socialize oftentimes with a Ben Lemon as an example on the lending side. Who's a dear friend, one of my closest friends even still today. And then I look at what we're doing with North Star Title and what an extraordinary situation that is. And as we've come forth and we've opened the doors of North Star Title, of course, just the name itself is really that it is really a place where you look for direction. It's where people truly come home to being able to close on their property. As you know, I sat on the Senate floor a year and a half ago with Sam Bell, and a number of other brokers and owners and people who were very, very convinced that the idea of a real estate company having ownership and a position in the title and escrow world in Utah was paramount. One of the reasons is one, we want to make sure that we can do a couple of things. One, charge the homeowners, if we can, a little less, and buyers. And number two, that we can charge even agents less as we see compressions going on, even in commission structures across the industry. It's critical that we are playing as one team and one single solitary entity, if you would say, in regards to escrow, title, mortgage, and all the other things that we do because of the importance of doing that. And then Russ has thrown up the one team with All Valley Escrow, of course, and the great work that they do there in California. And then, of course, our NHD company, and we even have a notary company. But with that, I just want to point out that one, I've been asked oftentimes about North Star and the importance of that. One, we want to give a greater experience to not only the agent, but to the client. And I'm so excited for what Kim Cruz and her team, who is obviously leading that out, and Sam Bell has been a huge part of that, and a number of other key leadership individuals who have helped us develop this thing. And this has been something that we have not taken lightly. We've done it very diligently. In fact, we had many, many, many meetings with our dear friends, Louis Hamner, Sue Cragen, and of course, Jeff Poulton. And they still are incredible friends. I mean, just in 2 weeks from now, I'll be going on a golf trip with Jeff Poulton, who is an owner in Vanguard, if you're not aware of that title company, who's had a nice and a wonderful, beautiful impact on our company. But I want to point out the importance of this and the importance of creating these types of organizations around Everest. It's not just because we have nothing better to do. It's because of the importance of creating a better system and a better structure to the real estate transaction. If we look at this on a national play and a national level, what you're seeing is really what has been talked about for nearly two decades, a one-stop type of shop where you go to one company and you get all the necessary things that you need. And with that, I am so excited with everything that we're doing. So please take time to walk into the doors of North Star. Take time to walk into the doors of Inspiro. And with that, I want to leave you with this next slide, which is Elevate, which is our December 3rd or December 1st event for agents. And there'll be more coming out on this. I hope to see you there. We had a huge amount of response to the last one that we did, and I hope that you'll be part of it. It's going to be great. We also have one for team leaders and for managers, broker owners, recruiters, but most importantly, for those of you listening today, team leaders in relationship to a manager slash leadership event, which will be December 3rd. So mark your calendar. I hope that you'll be able to attend. the Elevate, and we spent about 2.5 hours together a few weeks ago, and we're going to keep doing that because of the importance of that. And with that, I want to turn my time over to one of my dear friends and someone who has had a profound impact on my life and the health and my well-being. In fact, all three of these people have, but we're first going to start with Dr. Todd Cameron, who also owns the Cameron Wellness Center in Sugar House, Utah. He's a gentleman who is, of course, well-versed in the education of medicine, but he also has an incredible bedside manner and someone who I so thoroughly enjoy to get counsel and advice from in regards to my health and my well-being. And so I'm just so pleased and excited that he's been willing to spend a little bit of time with us. And he is someone unquestionably that if you even have a sniffle, he's the guy that you need to go see. Love him to death. And so I'll turn the time over to Dr. Todd Cameron. And after we do that, of course, we'll be hearing from Sharon and Paige and how to work on the mental and the emotional side of our lives, and should be a great hour ahead. So here we go. Dr. Cameron, the floor is yours.
Thank you, George. Appreciate it very much. I'm going to take a moment and get my slideshow up and running. Okay, can you guys see that?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, okay. All right, well, on Douglas Adams' Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, right on the first page of the book, right there, that's what it says. It says, don't panic. And I'm gonna be running through quite a bit today rather quickly because I wanna leave some time for questions that you might have. A little bit about my background. I'll just let you read it. I was an EMT back in the 70s. I was basically a climbing bum. I never thought I'd be going to school. Then a climbing partner talked me into going to nursing school, which I still can't figure out how that happened. And then I discovered naturopathic medicine, and I didn't even know it. I was headed towards emergency medicine. And anyway, I took a left turn. So what I do is naturopathic functional medicine, basically. And we'll just jump right into it because I'm telling you, there's not a day that goes by, and I'm sure the other practitioners will say the same thing. I'm talking people off the ledge every day, every single solitary day. And my side is more of the functional medical side, but that includes the mental, emotional, and spiritual aspect of who somebody is. So this list is just a sort of list. It's not a complete list by any stretch of the imagination. But I do want to leave you guys today with some real, understanding on what's going on, where the stress goes. Because one of the things that I was asked to talk about is where does the stress actually go? Well, all those symptoms that you just saw here, they can be in a number of different spheres. And it's my job working with my patient to figure out what sphere. Is it thyroid? Is it adrenal? Is it sex hormone? And those are the largest spheres. There's others, but these are the biggest spheres. And some of these are blood studies. Some of them are physical examinations with questioning. And we try and tease out where are those symptoms coming from. So a real quick on what the adrenals do, the stress that we experience, basically we have a hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis, HPA axis, and the A is the adrenal aspect of it. And in this day and age, and before I finish my presentation, you'll be clear on why, I can show people how stressed out they actually are. They might even say to me, well, I don't feel that stressed out. And it's like, usually it's because you've lost a frame of reference. And that largely started in 2016 during the presidential campaign. People just started getting very, very, very concerned about the world. And that concern has gone into their body. And this is just a little blip on what the adrenals do. So then the thyroid, of course, is right here, because the stress that goes in that affects the adrenal gland also affects not only sex hormone production, which I'm not talking about today, but also how not only what the thyroid produces, but how you change one hormone that's inactive into another thyroid hormone that is active. So this is just a short run of what the thyroid actually does, keeping in mind that the more stressed out we get, the more of those symptoms we're going to experience, the more it affects the adrenal and the more it affects the thyroid function. So just a note on everybody is different. When I'm treating people, they always inevitably ask me, for example, if I'm treating them with either testosterone, estrogen, progesterone, or DHEA or thyroid or whatever, they'll say, well, what do you think my dose is going to be? And it's like, wow, because we're so biochemically different, I honestly can't say what their dose is going to be. So what I get when I do blood studies and stuff like that is I get a compass bearing, I get a direction to go. And then listening to their body and their mind and their emotions, that will tell us, where we're going to go. William Osler happens to be one of my heroes. So this is something that you guys can do at home. I wanted to present it very quickly for you so that you can actually have a workable functional thing that you can actually do at home. You don't have to pay anybody to do it. All you need is a battery powered blood pressure cuff. And you can buy one of those for $35 at any pharmacy. And you put it on your upper arm. You lie down. I say lie down for 10 minutes. Being quiet and calm. You take your blood pressure. You wait 1 minute. You take your blood pressure again. Have somebody note it, of course. Wait 1 minute and then stand up and then take your blood pressure. Wait 1 minute and take your blood pressure. What's supposed to happen is this. A normal person, and these are pretend numbers, but they illustrate what I'm trying to talk about. So if you have a mild adrenal dysfunction, if you're normal, when you stand up, gravity works and your blood is going to fall away from your brain towards the center of the earth. And your brain has to compensate by calling down to the adrenal glands and closing as the tubes below the heart begin to close as you're standing up, so the blood doesn't fall away from the brain. Until that happens, the brain hollers down to the adrenals holler up to the heart, and your blood pressure comes up. That's what's supposed to happen. So a normal person, when they stand up, their blood pressure should come up, that the upper number, the top number, what they call the systolic number, the highest number, should come up from 10 to 20 points. In a mild dysfunction, you're gonna stay relatively the same. In a moderate dysfunction, you're gonna drop up to about like 10 points. And then in a severe, you're gonna plummet. And usually get a little lightheaded, like, last time you guys had a cold and you had to get up in the morning, go to the bathroom, got up and you kind of brown out a little bit, you hang onto the wall, ooh, get a little lightheaded. That's what I'm talking about here. So this is a very, very easy thing to do at home. So if somebody has a mild, and I'm telling you, I'm not exaggerating when I say that, well, I'll just say that in the past month, the people that we've seen that aren't in adrenal insufficiency, maybe two or three people total. So usually people have some level of it. And the mild, I just have them like start taking a quarter teaspoon of salt and water every day. And that should give the electrolytes that help the adrenal glands. And usually that's helpful. If it's moderate or severe, we really gotta go a different direction. And if it's real severe, and boy, could I tell you stories of both colleagues and patients of mine that have had been in very severe adrenal dysfunction, and it messes with everything in your life. Anything that's going on with you that you don't like, add stress and it gets worse. Okay, quickly on the thyroid, not taking too much time. Basically adrenal and thyroid and some sex hormone dysfunction, you're just going to be lethargic a little bit. Over time, it's going to get worse. You're not going to be as happy. Your sky's not as blue. Grass isn't as green. Why can I gain weight like crazy, but I can't lose weight? And, what's the rest of these symptoms? So not to get into too much detail here, but I've been through nursing school and medical school, and what they teach you is not anywhere close to correct enough to really uncover what's going on. So what's really interesting to do Here's just a little bit about the hypothalamus and the pituitary and the thyroid, and I won't go too much into that, except for to point out to you, notice the T3 and the RT3, okay? And that's going to be important in just a moment. So here's how we look at it. If you look at what I do is I take these numbers and I plot them on a speedometer graph, because the numbers can lie. Numbers that come from labs can and do lie. And so I never look at the number as if it's gospel truth. I look at the number so I can do a pattern with my arrows on the speedometer graph, and I can see what the pattern is, because the thyroid makes T1, T2, T3, and T4, but it mostly makes T4. And then we measure the free version of it, which is unbound. If you're bound to a protein, you can't do anything, but if you're unbound, you can be active. And the most biologically active form of thyroid by far is unbound or free T3. If you can think of the energy production at your cellular level as a symphony orchestra, T3, free T3 is the conductor of that symphony orchestra. So we'll take the blood, we'll graph it on a speedometer graph that goes from 0 to 100 miles an hour. So you're looking at three graphs. This is one I'm going to go into in a moment, but this person has got genetically low production, so they have a production problem. But if you look at the free T4 and then compare it to the reverse T3, which I can't see on my screen, but you can see the end of the needle is going very close to zero. Even though this person has a thyroid production problem, they don't have a conversion and a utilization issue probably. This person does. You see how the free T4 is going faster than the free T3. That is the first pattern I do not want to see. And then covered by faces over on the right of your screen is the reverse T3. And what I do not want to see is that the reverse T3 is getting anywhere near as close as, close to, or faster than the T3. Then we know we have a conversion problem and we have a utilization problem. So with this individual, I can start them on the kind of thyroid that I take, which is desiccated porcine thyroid. It's got T1, T2, T3, and T4 in it. This person, if I start them on anything with T4, I'm going to make them worse. I did not learn this in medical school. I learned this from my mentors after I got out of medical school and was going into residency. It's incredibly important, but nobody understands it. I teach all of my patients about it. I've taught every resident that's come through, every one of my nurses. They all understand these patterns, and they understand that it isn't the number, it's the pattern. You've got to look at the pattern, okay? So, and the problem with the adrenal and thyroid connection like this is that fatigue can be coming from adrenal or thyroid or both. Okay, so the other two practitioners I'm sure are going to go more into the mental emotional. I'm going to touch on it. You know, we've got a pandemic. I could talk about that all day long. And we've got all these other stressors. And if you don't think that electromagnetic fields are stressors, they most certainly are to ourselves. So I was asked to give some options for viral prevention. I know I'm kind of bouncing around here, but this is something that maybe you can get. I'm happy to send it to anybody in an email or whatever, but this is what we've been, I've added to another doctor's, you can go to that link there and find the other physician. I've kind of built on what he came up with. And this is a good way to keep you and your family healthy, not only from SARS-CoV-2, but also from any rhinovirus or adenovirus or any there's only about 4 or 5 coronaviruses that actually cause upper respiratory. The one we have now is the latest. But this will help with bacterial infections, any kind of upper respiratory tract infection, any infection at all. And this is kind of a one pager that I wanted to offer you guys so that I wouldn't get off this call and have people call me up and say, why don't you tell me what to do? It's like, well, if you're at home, this is what you do. Okay, quickly again, because I won't go too far into the mental emotional stuff, but excuse me, take a sip of water. Psychoneuroimmunology is and psychoneuroimmunoendocrinology are relatively new fields of medicine that are looking on how is the body actually the subconscious mind? How do we know that happy cells are healthy cells? Well, we're getting more and more scientific evidence of that. I didn't add that in because I didn't think you wanted me to waste time on referencing, but you guys can, you know, you can go to any PNI website and you can start looking at a really fun movie to watch is What the Bleep Do We Know? There's a lot of researchers and physicians on that movie that are working closely on, you know, how are we all connected? How is our mind and our body connected? Because when Rene Descartes, hundreds of years ago, separated the brain and the body, the mind and the body, all of a sudden we weren't connected. And it's like, I remember my mom before she died, she says, oh, maybe it's all in my head. And I go, well, wait, mom, let me see. Where's your head start and your neck? And she'd say, oh, you know what I mean. And I'd say, well, oh, you know what I mean. So it's all connected. So how do we keep cells happy? And I broke it down. One of my favorite books ever is The Fifth Agreement by Miguel Ruiz. And I read a little bit of it every day. And first of all, yeah, don't worry, be happy. Sounds easy, right? It's not. I get it. But the nice thing about it, hitting your head against the walls when you stop. So being impeccable with your word, you got to know what that means. Don't take anything personally, but you got to know what that means. Make no assumptions, but you got to know what that means. I have to make assumptions in medicine. That's called a differential diagnosis. But I don't have to make assumptions about me and you. Try your best and be skeptical, but learn to listen. Those are all the tenets of this book. And I suggest everyone get a copy of that and start reading it and never stop. I used to keep it by the toilet, but then one of my dogs chewed it up, so I brought it up here. I'll leave you with a couple of things. This is what we know we know. This is what we know we don't know. And this is what we don't know we don't know. We are in the field of all possibilities. You are in the field of possibilities, and you know that intuitively. So anything is possible. Everything is connected. And that's all I'm going to say. And then I'll turn it over to question and answer. That was fast and furious.
So Dr. Cameron, let me ask you this. And one, thank you. And boy, you've done such great work specifically. I mean, not that I know we have a couple hundred people on this deal, but my little 13-year-old daughter who's had an array of different challenges, and you and I haven't even spoken about this, but she's doing great. I mean, ever since we started spending some time with you specifically for what she was dealing with in regards to her thyroid. So it's pretty amazing the difference. Like this morning I was looking at her and she was bright-eyed and happy and walking through the kitchen. And I thought, and I asked her, how are you feeling? And she looked at me and said, what are you like acting like I've offended her by asking her how she's doing? And of course she gave me her normal attitude that used to be there, which was, I'm fine. Why are you even asking me? And I'm like, okay, sounds great. Looks like you're back to normal. So it's been kind of fun to watch her journey and the impact that you've had in regards to her mental well-being. Her commitment to schoolwork has always been there, but much higher since she started over these last 2 or 3 weeks working with you. And even just what you've got within your clinic, the acupuncture and everything else. I mean, it's just been a real thing to watch and observe that I've been so impressed by. So it's awesome. So here's my question though.
Yeah, go ahead.
What every moment I turn, right? Someone's talking about, of course, the virus. What's just your take in general on the actual virus? And I know that there's all the political charge of that. There's all the, from the constitutional freedom side of it to don't tell me what to do, but just in its core, I mean, sometimes people act like the virus doesn't exist, but that seems a little ludicrous. Like, what's just your take on the virus?
Yeah, so just as a little tiny bit of background, this is maybe the 35th or 36th coronavirus that we've discovered. We've discovered the first coronavirus in 1965. So coronaviruses are not anything. This particular virus, what they call a novel SARS-CoV-2, it's got peculiar aspects to it. I've, as a physician, I've studied the capsid and the genome, and you know, and it's questionable what, you know, what, and if personally for me, whether it was created in a lab or wasn't created in a lab, I don't really care, because there's lots of things that are created in labs. And if people don't believe that, all they got to do is read journals about the microbiologists and the work in these level four places. They're talking back and forth to each other all the time. They have journals, they have, you know, so to say that it doesn't, you know, it couldn't exist in that way is ludicrous, but to say that it is, we don't know. But it doesn't really matter. It's the virus itself is one of about four or five coronaviruses that actually cause upper respiratory tract infections. So, but of course it's real. What I've been doing, and this might be of interest to you, ever since April, I've been calculating, I used to do it every day, and then I stopped doing it every day, and I did it about once a week. And I stopped doing different countries around the world, and I focused on the world, the United States, and Salt Lake County. And what I was calculating was, relative to the number of positive tests, what is the percent death rate? Not how many people have died, what is the percent chance that you're going to die if you get corona? And the highest I've ever calculated in Salt Lake County is 1.4. I just calculated it last week, it was 0.37. In the United States, it hovers around 4 or 5, maybe 6 is the highest. I haven't calculated it in the last couple of weeks. And the world, as high as it's ever been that I've calculated, was 7. So I think what we're looking at here is any virus is dangerous. A very dear friend of mine who I grew up with, whose father and my father grew up together, he was 63 years old. He just died a couple of months ago. I just sprinkled his ashes into the Snake River. And he died, he died of anoxia of the brain, no oxygen to the brain. But what got him into the hospital was influenza A. So he was not positive to COVID. So there, I won't bore you too much unless you guys ask specific questions, because I've made it my business to find out a lot about this, but on the scientific basis, not the, you know, some of what I talk about to people sounds conspiracy theory, but it's really not. It's just, you can go find the data. The data is there, but we are having a little bit more response to it. But unfortunately, what I see happening is, just last week, I talked to two mothers whose children had tried to commit suicide. My own family member, a nephew of mine, was hospitalized with suicidal ideation. These kids are all around 13 to 16 years old. And we just have to reach out with so much love for these kids and just help them ground and help them know that, you know, it's going to be okay. We're going to be okay. Unfortunately, people die, but they die every year. This is a little bit more than usual. Okay, granted, I get that. But that doesn't mean that, you know, it's all, you know, the world's going to hell in a handbasket, but you wouldn't know that to look at the politics.
Right.
I'm not sure I answered your question.
Well, here's my question. So obviously the virus is real. Obviously, yeah. Take reasonable precaution. But I mean, my daughter, who sat in a meeting with masks on and everything else, and just a few days ago was diagnosed with the virus, with COVID. And, you know, I find it interesting that here she sits in the very room where it gets transmitted, and she's, you know, wearing her mask like a good trooper in regards to what is being said we should be doing. I'm asking probably a pretty controversial question. Give me your take, if you're willing to, in regards to masks. I mean, there's the mandates of both Utah, California, where the majority of our people reside. But what's your take in regards to masks and the importance of quarantining and social distancing? And kind of just give us your perspective in that arena.
Sure. There's part of it that makes perfect sense. And then there's part of it that is makes no sense. So here's an analogy. A virus is a small thing. So if I had, if this were a red blood cell, a L-form bacteria would be smaller than the point of my pen. And a virus is a whole lot smaller than that. So I'm not saying that masks don't do good things. They do, but mostly what they're going to do is they're going to stop the water particles that have gravitational field that are heavy enough that will fall. And so I don't spit on you. So, you know, sure, it makes sense. And I'm, and we respect other human beings just by wearing it when I go to Lowe's or when I go to the grocery store. Of course, they make you do it anyway, but you know, I'll do it to respect you and to respect your space. I'll just do that. But I could be standing on Cape Cod, for example, and I could breathe through my mask, and water particles can get very, 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 very small too. And a virus can be attached to the water particle, and it could get on the wind and end up in whales. And so have you, my question to people is, have you ever seen a cloud fall? I know that you've seen rain fall, but you go outside in the cloud and you look up in the cloud, and is that cloud falling? No, the cloud's not falling. Why is that cloud not falling? Gravity works. It works on everything because the water particles are so small. It's like a colloid. It's like something in a liquid that electromagnetically stays suspended, right? Well, so masks don't do anything about a virus that can get through. It's only going to help with water particles. But you know, if you want to stop a virus, you've got to have, and I'm sure you guys doing construction and stuff, like I used to paint when back in the day, sheetrock and paint, and you know, we'd wear these, but that's before they had low volatile oil paints. This is back in the 70s. And so we'd wear a mask, we'd put Vaseline all over our face, and we'd wear a mask with canisters on it that would cut, you know. So if you did something like that, that would stop some of the virus. I mean, when I go take my dogs up to the foothills and I see people wearing a mask and they're walking alone, I'm just scratching my head. It makes no rational sense whatsoever. It just doesn't. But I'm not going to tell them that because I respect the way that they think and the, right. What they want to do. That's fine.
And then everyone's coming from a different angle, right? I mean, from that standpoint.
Yep. And it's right. You're right. It's controversial.
I could talk to you forever, man. I love spending time with you. So I just hope you know how much we appreciate you. And we've been asked if you're willing to take on any new clientele. And I know I've asked you that prior to, and that would be the same for both Sharon and Paige. I believe that everyone's very open to that. And I think you'd love to see some of our group, which I know you see a number of different agents. I know Jessica Terry and Jared Schneider were patrons of yours. I know Sam Bell got pneumonia, came and saw you, and gosh, suffers with that almost every single year. And all of a sudden, you know, he starts seeing you and he hasn't had challenges with it. I know Rob Oakey, one of our managing brokers, bronchitis, goes and sees you on occasion when he really has the challenges with the bronchitis. So you just thank you for being a blessing to so many lives.
You betcha. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. So okay. If we can, Danette or Dr. Campbell, one of you, let's just make sure that we put your contact information, everything in there, so they know how to get a hold of you and they can come see you if they want to.
I have Dr. My team, I have a great team. I have Dr. Postma, who helped me with the IT stuff. He's a lot more IT than I am. And then Katrina, I think George, are one of our nurses that is in a doctoral program now. I really, really appreciate our team, and we have room for more patients for sure. We do.
I'm sorry, because you've kind of expanded your team a little bit.
Yeah, we have, and we're overwhelming Katrina right now because she's in a doctoral program, and she's just we keep throwing GI patients at her, and she's brilliant, and she's fast, and she's good. And so, but yeah, we do. We're kind of a full service, mostly though. Just to give you an idea, you know, we focus on IV therapy for sick people. That means anybody from colds to cancer. We focus on, you know, what you just saw me do, the endocrinological stuff and hormones. And we focus on GI stuff. And we do a lot of stuff. You can go to our website, CameronWellnessCenter.net, and get a better understanding of what we do.
Yeah. Well, I keep seeing all these chat people come. John Side, who's seen you, Lindsay Wardle, who's seen you, April Oaks, I believe, has seen you, but I know her mother for certain when she got really sick came to see you. When nothing else seems to work, you seem to be the guy they all turn to. And I know you've had also, you just, and I'll close with this, you've helped a lot of people that when they're going through things like Lyme's disease, cancer, and really this balance between that homeopathic side and them getting some of the traditional treatments that you see out there. I know that you're even the person who helps people who don't, so they don't lose their hair when they're going through chemo. I mean, there's all sorts of cool things I know that you do to bless the lives of other people. So thank you for being part of our lives.
Hey, thanks, you guys. All right, brother.
Okay. All right. All right.
I'll see you.
Turn the time. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Dr. Cameron. We're going to turn the remainder of our time up until about 5 or 10 minutes to it. We're going to turn it over to Sharon Noble and Paige Palmer, back by high demand, and they've got some great stuff and doing some great things and really expanded their program. I'm not necessarily going to name agents and individuals who have spent time with them, but I just know this, that the impact that Sharon and Paige have had in my life personally and in the lives of my family and the way in which I lead and the way in which I operate has been profound and frankly miraculous as I look back over the years I've spent with them. I am incredibly grateful for them. So with that, Paige and Sharon, the time is yours. Thank you so much for being with us.
Well, thank you, George. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, we can hear you loud and clear.
Awesome. Well, we're glad to be back. It's been an interesting period of time since the last time we were here. I think we were here about 6 months ago. And I'm just wondering, how's your 2020 going?
You know what? Good news, we're in real estate, so that's going good.
Yeah.
But you know what? There's still the mental side, right, for everybody. And there's the mental equation that, and it depends on where they're coming from, right? But you heard Dr. Cameron talk about those stresses and that adrenal and the thyroid and all of it mixing the stress and the lack of sleep and the unknown. So it'll be, it's good, but as you know, there's those challenges still at the same time.
Yeah, it's an amazing moment in history. I mean, I look at 2020, New Year's Eve, Sharon was writing in her journal. She was looking forward to 2020 and she said, stated what she wanted to have happen. Do you remember what that was?
Oh, I was like, let's go 2020. This is going to be a year of joy, pleasure, all great things. You know, bring it on.
Bring it on. She had to ask. Right. Yeah. So since that time, we've had coronavirus. We've had unbelievable historic fires all over California. We've had earthquakes here. Invisible hands reached from the sky in Salt Lake, plucked out our favorite trees out of Liberty Park. Horrifying winds, you know, it's been an amazing murder hornets. I mean, a Marvel comic designed bug that can kill all of our bees. You know, it's been truly the strangest year in my 64 years. I came up through, really came of age in the 1960s. And there were some weird moments. 1968 was intense. This is stranger. I don't know that it is as hard, but it is stranger by far. And I loved what Dr. Cameron had to say in the last 2 years. This didn't just start, you know, New Year's Eve of 2020. This has been percolating in us. We've been in a big, long set of really pandemics, politics, and problems. That is affected all of us, and it's affected our adrenal glands, our thyroid glands, and everything. And it's showing up in our bodies in really amazing ways. And I know Dr. Cameron has his version of that in his office. We certainly have that in ours. And it's a backdrop for what we work with now in our office. We're therapists, we work with couples. The two of us meet with couples and we work with couples simultaneously. We're a couple. We're partners in the world. We're living in this soup ourselves. Mm-hmm. This has been an amazing crucible to pass through. I mean, a crucible is a situation you're put in. It gets heated up and it refines who you are. It drives off the dross. Mm-hmm. When we were last here, we talked about a question and an observation that I had made, which is, you know, you're going to move through this thing. You can have a choice between just reacting or responding to it. But as you go through it, you're going to come out of it a little better, a little worse, or about the same. And some of you are going to be able to say, well, I'm a little better and I'm a little worse. And others are going to say, well, I'm about the same. That hasn't really affected me. The pandemic and all of these three Ps of pandemics, politics, and problems and all that we've seen, it reveals what's there and it affects us in very real ways. And I know Sharon wants to talk about some of the research from American Psychological Association about that, because it's helpful. People are studying this and how it affects our bodies. And there's some things to learn about it. And
Paige, I was gonna say that the hardest thing and the why I love having you and Sharon and of course, Dr. Cameron and others
is that the biggest challenge right now is trying to figure out what to believe. Mm-hmm. You know, what's the truth? And so, you know, one thing I've learned from you, and then I'll turn the rest of the time over. I won't say anything else until we open up for maybe some questions and whatnot. But I would just say that one of the things that you have both taught me well is that most of the answers are residing already inside of me. Mm-hmm. And that in itself, aside from always trying to look to the media, mm-hmm. to you, to others, you know, something I sent you today was my ability to self-discover and learn from within versus always looking from without for something to give me my answer. And I have always appreciated about the fact of one of my great loves of both of you is that you've helped me become more independent and less dependent upon things outside of me, which is really powerful. So with that, Sharon, I'll be quiet. I'm even going to mute myself. I can't even say anything more. I'm muting myself, Sharon.
No. George, thank you. That's perfect, because really that's the driving idea behind our talk today, really. It's about when you get into the crucible, mm-hmm. Dr. Cameron talked about the brain or the body, brain-body systems, how we respond to threat, what happens. It's a full brain-body experience, right? So what do we do when our brain is under threat? Well, we seek to control what is outside of ourselves. It can look like any number of things. It could be seeking to control our partners so that we regulate our own feelings of discomfort or anxiety or distress. And now we have all these things occurring in our outside world that's bringing feelings inside of us. Mm-hmm. The American Psychological Association, for anyone out there right now who is feeling, Dr. Cameron talked about people with, you know, suicidal thinking and depression. There are people with anxiety right now and a sense of threat. For anyone experiencing that, that's also normal during these times. Let's be honest. We will, there are moments to respond to the moment or react to the moment, okay? But these are feelings that are arising in all of us in any number of moments in our life. So the big thing that the American Psychological Association is noticing is people have a lot of discomfort and intolerance for uncertainty. Intolerance of uncertainty. That creates anxiety and it creates a sense of depression or some sense that we can't quite control what is going on outside of ourselves.
Or we can't even figure out what's accurate information because there's conflicting messages coming that creates uncertainty. I have to tell you that when the American Psychological Association says that we don't have any tolerance for uncertainty, I burst out laughing when I heard that because I thought, if you're not dropping dead of a coronary right now, you have remarkable tolerance for uncertainty. I mean, there's never been a time with such profound uncertainty. That affects the brain. It affects every system in your body. Here's what it also affects. It affects your consciousness. Because human beings have eyeballs built in the front of their heads that look out at the world. They don't look inside. Now, that may seem obvious to you, but it's profound. We look out at the world. And we've been looking and trying to detect threat our whole evolutionary history. We listen for sound outside. Our skin alerts us to what's outside. We're orienting outside looking for threats. If you find detect threats early, you survive. We all have very successful ancestors in survival, in detecting threats and surviving. We know that because we're here. Unsuccessful people in our evolutionary history, they didn't have descendants, okay? The ones who survived had remarkable abilities to look out at the world, to literally map the world and detect where the threats were. Consequently, we're here, but we're well designed for a consciousness devoted to detecting threat. We got really remarkable in our way of responding to threat. It happens in seconds. We can size up situations, and in our evolutionary past, we had to notice who was friend and who was foe in seconds or we're out of the gene pool. We're good at mapping the minds and intentions of other people, except when threat becomes chronic. And then everything looks risky. The sense in the experience is somehow I'm a risk starts to take over. Our amygdalas begin to fire. These old reptilian brains that do fight, freeze, and flee. as active. It starts to interfere with our prefrontal lobe's ability to just notice what's going on, to regulate our emotions, and to be in reality in a real sound way. We literally get compromised in our ability to assess what's out there. And our reptilian brain is firing on every cylinder and it's racing. And that's why our adrenals are in the shape they are.
Mm-hmm. And that's us in reaction rather than in response to the moment that is in front of us. And on that note, we're gonna switch gears. And we're going to get up and start to shake our bodies. And we're inviting all of you right now in this moment to please step away from your screens and shake your bodies with us. Russ, please cue the music.
By the way, this is science.
I've been drinking muddy water, sleeping in a hollow log. Been drinking muddy water, sleeping in a hollow log. Lord, if I can't be your kid, man, I ain't gonna be your dog. I roll and I tumble while they hold my nose. I roll and I tumble.
Okay. So let us review this moment.
Indeed.
Everyone. So here we go. How did you face this moment, this invitation to get up and flail your body spastically with us? So let's look at reactive brain. Wow, I'm really needing to catch my breath right now. That's not a good sign. Okay, reactive brain. Some of you maybe were in fight. Your screens are muted. You told us what we could do with ourselves in that moment.
A lot of judgment there in the fighters, yeah?
Or in judgment. Some people chose to flee. They thought, oh, this is a really good time. I'm going to go into the kitchen and get a banana.
Sure.
Or perhaps it's time for me to check on the dog.
Or just check out of this presentation.
Yep. So that's... flee. And then there's also free. Some of you maybe perhaps sat glued to your seat, staring in horror at the scene in front of you. That's another possibility. So those are reactions of the brain,
yep,
under an experience of threat. And really, was there threat there? It was about some thoughts that created the experience that this is perhaps a threatening moment. Then there's flow. There are those of you that chose to get out of your seat and just shake your body with us, right?
It's kind of, what the hell do I have to lose? I think I'm just going to give it a shot. Why not? Let's see what happens. These are four basic responses to threat. They're built into our systems. The first three, they're not chosen. Fight, freeze, or flight. They're the automatic responses that kept our ancestors alive and in the gene pool. They're not really chosen. They're actually there before you're five. And it's kind of amazing. It's really amazing. We become largely driven by our reactions before we're about 12 for sure, 15 absolutely. This stuff gets wired early. And then for the rest of our lives, we live locked into a set of reactions. Those reactions are going to become more available to our consciousness right now in a period of threat. Because there's so much threat, we feel the weight of it. It's really intense. By the way, thank you, Leslie. There's a bunch of people out there who went ahead and danced more than I expected. And they're laughing out loud. They're saying it was awesome. They went with flow. They had fun. It's one of the interesting characteristics when we can step out of our reactive mindset, when we can step into a conscious reconsideration.
A response
instead of a reaction. We become the authors of our own lives. We become conscious beings who, somewhere between the trigger and the reaction, there's a pause. To use the phrase in England, mind the gap. Keep your mind in that gap. Notice that space between the trigger and the reaction and choose to respond and see what happens in that space. Things become possible.
So what we said earlier, 6 months ago, whenever we were here, George, it was some will feel worse off during these times. Some will feel neutral, unchanged mostly. And some will really feel like they're in a position where they're feeling fertile. They're growing themselves and they're actually meeting this moment beyond what they perhaps would have expected. And so let's look at what we just did. It sure looks silly, but actually it's like a Qigong practice. It's rooted, it's millennia old in Asian practices for spiritual, emotional, physical health. And actually the shaking, I don't know if any of you out there have a dog or a cat, but have you ever seen them shake their bodies from the tip of their nose all the way down to their tails? Because if you've seen them do that, you can see that it's the body's natural brain body reset. It's our nervous system reset. And these animals do it naturally. And so do we as animals. We have this gear in our body and they're using it to relieve trauma now. There are programs that they're doing for chronic pain, better sleep, and release of tension and trauma. And think about what this year has brought. We're bracing ourselves, many of us. There's a physical brace going on in our body that we may not have even registered because we become adapted to it. We don't even notice our brace. And when you shake it out, there you go. You get to release that and you tell your brain body all is well. So
it's interesting. Almost all indigenous cultures that some people refer to as primitive cultures, still dance and shake. It's a way of processing the tension, the stress, and even the traumas of daily life. That's powerful. That's really, really powerful. And there's people who are recognizing this now. There's a neurogenic yoga that's one of the ways of using this. We're able to free ourselves from nervous tension by doing things that we've been naturally doing for a really long time. But it has to become a response, because reactivity will only keep you where you've been. Is your thoughts about the work that you've done with us, George? They're fascinating because they really are what we're about. We've been working on really cultivating consciousness and conscious connection. That's the thing that we work at on a daily basis, to cultivate conscious connection, first with ourselves, then with our intimate partners, our families, our communities in the world. We think isomorphically, meaning one whole. I begin with me, but it radiates out. It includes my most intimate partners. Then the next ripple includes my children. The next is my family or tribe or my pack or crew, however you think about it. Outside of that, it's this community that we live in. I don't know that I've ever seen a time in my life when people were divided up so much. I didn't know that there were red and blue people until recently. Mm-hmm. Apparently there's entire states of only red people and blue people in some people's lives. This is an amazing notion. The truth is that the colors of us human beings are infinite and wide, and we are out of relationship with them, out of fear and reactivity. When our neighbors become people we cannot talk to because they have an idea that we cannot tolerate, or vice versa, we're in reaction. That is unnecessary suffering. It creates tension in our bodies, tension in the earth, and it creates unconsciousness. And people believe on a regular basis over history, the most unconscious things about others, like that they're witches. Okay, there's all kinds of things that go on. The challenge is to begin to see that we can think pretty crazy and we can start to detect threat everywhere. Sharon and I see couples most of the time together. And our work is to bring couples into consciousness, but there's one thing you have to know. You can't be a conscious couple until you become a conscious individual. And there are practices that can help you to become a more conscious human being so that you can move through this flotsam and jetsam of nonsense that exists around us that's causing us to be reactive instead of responding in a compassionate and loving way to our world. If you want to be a part of a compassionate, loving family or world, you have to embody compassion. That is a choice. but it is a hard won choice in a world full of reactive minds that are geared up to pursuing threat in the external. And so we have to look inward. We have to develop strategies for moving inside.
So I guess the big question to all of you, take a moment and notice what happened when we invited you to join us today. Notice what happened. Did you feel reactive in some way? It's just a moment of noticing. It's not a moment of judgment or, you know, any kind of contempt in yourself and how you perceive your experience.
In fact, it's only curiosity.
Curiosity. I like to call it compassionate curiosity. It's interest in your life. So notice what you did and then notice how you feel. I'm guessing for those of you that chose to step in and move your bodies, not only did you sit down again feeling more connected to yourself, your physical body, as well as how you felt. And if you smile, bonus, you get bonus years to your life because laughing and smiling actually improves your longevity. Isn't that a great way to improve longevity? So there's that too. So consciously cultivate connection. And also those of you who danced, maybe you even felt more connected to your community up there goofy and moving their bodies with you. That's another way to create.
It's connection. Strange, but I did because I expected everybody to be frozen in their seat or saying, what in the hell is wrong with this too? I mean, I expected a reaction that was less, that was more negative than what was there. And when you started sending your chat, I immediately start wiring with you. I'm becoming part of you. And it's amazing to me, we can truly become a part of each other in greater and greater ways if we're just willing to stop reacting and start responding.
And in terms of becoming a part of each other and feeling this social fabric that we're all a part of, this connectivity that exists by consciously cultivating connection and our actions and our orientation. In 2019, this is before the pandemic hit or the earthquake took us, you know, by surprise here in Utah. And the fires going in fury in California. In 2019, the government, the US, the Health Resources and Services Department put out an issue paper on the, what they call it, the loneliness epidemic. So this is before social isolation mandates quarantine. So these are times where truly, and you can feel lonely by yourself and you can feel lonely with others. And that's part of this consciousness of what you cultivate in your experience.
So we want to take you on a bit of a journey here. And there's a reason for this. There was a reason for doing Qigong there a minute ago. It was to get you to become aware of your body and to make perhaps conscious choices. I would really like to have you all join me in a mindfulness meditation. And I'll tell you why. Mindfulness meditation changed me. There's been two things that changed me more than anything else in my life. One is mindfulness meditation, and the other was eye gazing meditation with Sharon, looking in her eyes in a meditation. That was the most profound thing I've ever done because we did it for hours at a time. Don't do that at home, it's crazy. But it really elevated an internal awareness of ourselves and it evolved me. So I'd like you to just join me. So if you can interrupt what you're doing for a little bit and dial inward, to take that journey inward that George talked about a little bit earlier. I think you're gonna have an experience here that may be truly useful for you. If you've done mindfulness meditation, say yay, put your thumbs up on the chat. If you haven't done it, give me a thumbs down just so I know who's in and who's not about that. Great. I'm gonna ask you to just take a moment. Sit back in your seat and you just follow along. And we're going to do a mindfulness wander here. I don't really like to call it meditation. I actually like to call it just noticing because that's all we're going to do here. So if you can't, feel free to turn off your video if you don't want to be seen. But if you're cool with it, great. But just close your eyes and let's take this look inside and do absolutely nothing to just feel your feet on the floor. To really just get your sense of a connection with an earth that has supported you utterly and completely every day of your life, just to feel the earth beneath you. I mean, the magnitude of just connecting with this dirt ball, spinning it in space at 30,000 miles an hour is a remarkable thing. the note that it has supported you perfectly, and the sun rose today. And you just gradually become aware of your body, that feet, your feet connecting to the earth, your knees that have supported you on your journey through this life, your hips, even the tight ones. Notice your chest. See if you can feel into your own heart. Just become aware of your heart. It served you every day of your life. Ba-boom, 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 taking you forward. Notice your lungs, which serve you without any request. They're just there for you. I'm here, in, out. If you hold your breath, if you can hold your breath long enough to pass out, they will start up again and save you. They're utterly reliable, this body. Just stay with your awareness. Feel your face. Feel the top of your head. Notice the sky above you, the sun that rose this morning, which has served you and all of us every day. If it didn't, in 18 hours, we would all be gone. We're in a world that is utterly supportive of us, and this body carries us through it. And if you can find it in you, thank your body. Breathe in a big thank you. Exhale gratitude. Gratitude for the world, the universe, gratitude for this body, this life, this single moment to be truly conscious, to breathe in and breathe out. And now just follow your breath. And as you do, you just breathe in to a count of four, say, out to a count of eight, and follow your breath. And as you're breathing in and breathing out, thoughts will arise. That's your mind's job. Think for you, control everything. And just observe that you don't have to. You can just breathe. You can just follow your breath. And thoughts will rise, will fall away. Sensations will come. Pandemics will arise. Politics will come and go. Everything moving consistently. Breathing in, breathing out. Making that exhalation just a little bit longer and fuller and complete than the inhalation. And just witness the miracle of your very existence here in this moment. This conscious moment where you chose to respond to the earth, to your body, and to the moment. Here we are in this moment. And if there's any prayer here, it just has to be thank you.
Oh.
So take a deep breath in and bring yourself back into the room. Feel the room, notice the room, the light, everything. And here we are back again, having developed just a little bit bigger connection, a little bit deeper connection with ourselves. Here we are. This is our life. This is the miracle of the ordinary conscious mind.
So any moment in your day, any of you, here we sit in front of our computers often, really, you can get out of your seat. You can open your body. Opening your body changes your neurochemistry. That is one thing you can do. It can change your neurochemistry just by opening your body and not sitting closed in a space with our phones right in front of us, right, looking down. That's closure of the body, and that is associated with a kind of neurochemistry. A neurochemistry that does not support health, happiness, and well-being.
This is neurochemistry that changes the brain. In 90 days of this kind of meditation, you will rewire the connections between your reptilian brain and your prefrontal lobe. That's mind-blowing, by the way. We didn't know our brains would change. We can literally consciously construct gray matter in our brain in a practice like this. And that makes you more conscious. Well, more conscious for what? I mean, why would we want to be more conscious? I mean, what do you want to create in this world?
So one thing, we wanted to bring just a couple practices for you. We know you have full work days, and we wanted to offer a little bit of relief that you experienced during your time with us. I also, you know, we've talked about some hacks, just some hacks for you to do.
Sure, a life hack.
Yep. And how to maybe, so one thing that behavioral science has taught us, when we make choices and decisions, like New Year's Eve, where we decide we're all in, we're going to do this thing, we're going to change this behavior. New Year's Eve, we're at the peak of the motivation curve. And so we plan things like, I'm going to exercise every day for an hour. Or, you know, I'm going to completely eat only nutritious food. I'm going to be on a plant-based diet and no sugar will pass these lips. And so we have these grand ideas for ourselves. And then what happens when we get to the trough of our motivation after some period of time, we get to zero in our commitment. And when we're at zero in our commitment, we experience ourselves as having failed. We see ourselves and observe ourselves as not keeping our commitments. So one piece of advice from learning behavior science about motivation, if you want to experience the success of your life, you create goals that you can do no matter what. And one of those things could be a 5-minute goal. So one of the things I wanted to share with you, and we're gonna lump a bunch of hacks together for you, is we're gonna talk about the 5-minute goal of exercising, of walking in the morning. I'm just gonna use this as an example, okay? Getting up in the morning, all you need to commit to is 5 minutes in the morning. So what happens in that time? So if you meet the morning light, if you are able to first thing in the morning, get out and have the light hit your eyes actually have a brain material outside of your brain. That's the only other part of your body that has its own separate brain from your brain. And whether you are you're not, let's say you cannot see, it doesn't matter. This brain is there to set your whole body's circadian rhythm. Every cell in your body, no matter what it's informed about its purpose in your body, goes on a 24-hour clock. And when you wake up in the morning and you step outside, whether it's cloudy or not, and the UV rays actually are part of this, come into your eyes, you are setting yourself up for wakefulness, for your hormones to be on track, for your feel good, for your melatonin to turn off. Did you want to add something to this?
No, it's great. Keep going. I'm all ears.
So a doctor in Stanford, he made a comment that I saw that your brain, the pathways in your brain that control sleep and mood overlap 90%. So there's research showing that just that early morning light, not from a computer, not from your phone, but from being outdoors, will reset your whole system and set you up for success. Mood, diet, feelings, and behavior.
So this hack that Sharon's just described has you awaken, you go for a short walk. You can make it 5 minutes. You can make it 10 minutes. While you're out there, you're taking in sunlight, which is resetting your brain, your sleep-wake cycles, your rhythms, and so forth. Oh, there's all kinds of things going on. If you want to, you can include one more thing. You can find gratitude for 3 things on your walk. That's a 3-hack hack that's going to set you up for the day, change what you're doing. That's an economy of good things that you're consciously choosing. You see, we can consciously respond to our circumstances. We can bring in good things. We can create good practice. Just don't overwhelm yourself by saying, I'm going to go for a 45-minute run if you're not ready for that. Go for a 5-minute walk. Go for a 10-minute period on your porch and absorb the sun.
So here's another good piece of news about your morning walk. There's a neuroscientist from Stanford, Andrew Huberman, who I think is extraordinary. And he just talks about this forward movement in your body as objects pass you by. There is something about your eye movement back and forth as you're noticing the objects passing you by that calms your nervous system. So there's a woman, Francine Shapiro. She innovated EMDR. I don't know if anyone has heard of it.
Treatment for trauma.
And it is the systematic movement of eyes going back and forth. And she discovered it in a walk in the park where she had problems. And as she was moving and her eyes were moving, her problems tended to fall away. So there's something you can do, something a part of your morning walk.
Something you will do on your morning walk. The eyes tend to do this in that walk. That's what Francine observed, and it became the basis for a remarkable and revolutionary way of healing from trauma. You move your eyes back and forth, but you'll be doing that when you walk through your neighborhood or the field. There you are in the sun, going for your walk. Your eyes are moving. You're having a neurobiological experience that is shared with your environment. It's moving back and forth. These are hacks that you can become involved with. There's a million things you can find on the internet. There's smart information about drinking plenty of water, okay? And Dr. Cameron expanded on that. Make sure you're getting electrolytes and so forth and all that. Mm-hmm. But drinking water, getting plenty of sleep. There's great information online about how to sleep and so forth. I want to talk to you because our time's going to run out. We're about to 12 minutes after the hour.
I'm sorry, I'm interrupting my man here. Just one more thing. And it's about protecting your psychology, everyone. If I can give you one piece of powerful tool to take with you in this time, with George's thing about the media and what to believe in facts. Well, being on our phones not only rob us of an experience that we can have together that is intimate, the sense of connection, but there's something called doom scrolling. Many of us deciding at night before we go to bed to look at our phones and see what's happening in the news and just get caught up. And doom scrolling sets us up for poor sleep, sometimes insomnia. It certainly robs us of time that we could be sleeping. Here's another thing. There's plenty of research showing that people who are exposed to graphic things, either in text or in images about an event that took place, maybe even somewhere else, has these secondary effects that are very harmful to them. PTSD, depression, and anxiety being three of them that can actually be more felt by someone just reading about it or seeing images than people who actually have gone through some potentially traumatic experience. So social media feeds, if there are people feeding things in there that's causing you to feel distress in your body, have conscious connection to your body. Notice and choose maybe not to go to those feeds or to block those feeds. Do the things that are all about self-care for you and be conscious about it so you can create a different experience in your body during these times.
Well, one of the rules of consciousness is whatever you focus on expands. Whatever you focus on expands. You'll experience more of it. If you develop an interest in fly fishing, you're going to find there's a fly fishing shop on every corner and you never saw it before. Whatever you focus on expands. You become aware of it and you begin to select into it. If you're doom scrolling, that's affecting your consciousness. There are so many good things on the internet, so many good things in entertainment that can enhance you. Access them if you're committed to that. Or dock your phone and take a sobriety break from bad news, which will do you immeasurable good. These are hacks that you can look at that can improve your consciousness. There's some rules for consciousness. There's some practices for consciousness. I'm going to encourage you to develop a mindfulness practice. And you can access some recordings of mindfulness practices on the internet, certainly. Tara Brach, B-R-A-C-H, is a teacher of meditation. Amazing free meditations, a lot of others. There'll be some on our website that you can actually access too. We can talk about that later. 5 minute, 10 minute, 15, 20 minute different meditations. I want to talk about cultivating awareness through ritual. I grew up in a tradition with no rituals. Basically Thanksgiving, Christmas, and the 4th of July were our rituals. So I didn't really appreciate rituals until I got older. My son and I developed a ritual that we would do each evening. It was our tea ritual. We had a Japanese tebisin, a little cast iron teapot, and two lacquer mugs. And we would sit in our living room and we would sip tea. And he's about 14 when we start this, and we're in total silence. We're just hanging out. And it's kind of like two guys. You good?
Yeah, I'm good.
You know, it was just a celebration of our presence with each other. That's really what it was. And I want to encourage you to consider rituals, especially during this pandemic and the isolation that goes on. Rituals are ways of focusing attention and consciousness. Whether you're Catholic or Buddhist or whatever, we atheists are really good at it. Use a ritual to focus your consciousness on the present moment and celebrate your connection with yourself and your connection with another. And you do that by paying attention to the details. So one of the things that you might consider, another hack, if you will, a life hack during quarantine, develop a tea ritual in the evening. if that works for you. And it doesn't have to be tea, of course, it could be anything. It's a purposeful getting together. Sharon and I have a coffee ritual that we do every morning. We have specific mugs, we have specific processes, we have specific coffee, and we sit in each other's presence. And she says the most amazing things to me in those moments. And I tend to remember them and gather them because they're truly remarkable. These are moments of consciousness that we can cultivate and bring it together. Let me offer you one last one because we're going to run out of time. But consider rituals of greeting and parting when your partner comes and goes. We are so careless. We are so casual in our comings and goings. We don't pay proper respect. Oftentimes, our partner leaves and go, hey, all right, see you later. You know, have a good one. That's a way of saying goodbye to someone you don't know is going to come back, who you've built your whole life with. It's careless. Can you bring your presence to it? Can you really just stop and look at your partner, make some eye contact, say, swear, I'll miss you. And you just have a moment with me. There can be no words. Mm-hmm. There can be a connection. Mm-hmm. I look in her eyes, and the practice of having looked at her face for so many years bring me directly into relationship with her. The rituals of greeting and parting, how you say goodbye, how you say hello. Can you have a conversation? Can you bring your awareness to it?
So in that moment, what is the energy you bring to your moment, to your relationship? Are you bringing a 2 to your relationship and expecting a 10 in return? So right now, even in this moment, can you find where your energy is? Are you a 5? Are you a 6 or 7? Do you know how to find your 8 or 9, even in this moment, right here with this screen in front of you, to be awake, to be present, to be engaged,
to be conscious?
You have the power to make those decisions. And then when you're with your partner, if you bring yourself to that experience with the energy that shows the love and engagement that you want to experience yourself, that's what you're bringing. So
this is what we call consciously cultivating connection. If you don't make a conscious choice, you're still going to make a choice, but it's going to be an unconscious choice. When we bring consciousness to our relationships, we're crafting them in an authentic way. Otherwise, we're just reliving our parents' relationship, our cultural relationships, all the things that we were taught, the ways we were taught how to be and not to be. I mean, for me, I was taught not to be too powerfully emotional. When I felt too good, I had to shut it down. And like most men, I found that shelf in me to put all of the bad and good emotions that fell out of control and just shove it down. Well, that's costly. You become less alive, you become less conscious. So these practices are consciously cultivating connection with your partner. That's really what Sharon and I have devoted our lives to. Our personal lives and the conscious cultivation of our connection. But we do it with our clients. And George alluded to it earlier. When you connect fully with yourself, you're going to cut through more bullshit than you can believe. There is a knowingness in us that can transform the lives. Sharon and I, it's really the work we're doing. So what we're bringing actually online this month, we're doing a program called 12 Dates.
Transformation.
12 dates to transformation, because I believe that really, if you embody practices, if you learn practices and you repeat them daily, if you bring attention and consciousness to the connections you make with yourself, that transforms you. When you bring those connections to your partner, it transforms the relationship. And guess what happens to your tribe, your children, your friendships? You transform them. This is how we heal the world. By developing a connection with ourselves, you can do that through mindfulness, meditation, there's a whole host of possible ways of doing that. You can do it with your partner in some of the ways we've described and more. If you'd like to join us for that, feel free to check our website out. It's called
12datestolove.com.
12datestolove.com.
And if you're interested in being a part of it and joining us for this, just put in all capital letters, Everest20. And you will get 20% off. If you choose to do this within the next 48 hours, we want to give you a special deal because we are a huge fan of George's, and we want to offer this to all of you.
Yeah, so it's our way of trying to create a more conscious life, one couple at a time.
And, can you repeat that just one more time?
Yeah.
Because Danette's gonna write it into the chat box.
Perfect. Thank you. So it's 12 spelled out. So 12datestolove.com. And then it will be Everest 20 for your 20% off. If you choose to be a responder to this moment and just sign up, you get in the next 48 hours. That's what we're going to do. So we have that online set up for you.
We're also going to have some free resources, which will include some mindfulness meditations. And I'm a big believer in visualization as a way of transforming your mind. I spend anywhere from 20 minutes to an hour a day in visualizations. Frankly, getting in connection with my future evolved self. That guy's pretty smart. He's been places I have yet to go, but I hope to be. And he keeps bringing wisdom to me. You have a guide like that too, and you can cultivate that. It's breathtaking. So if you like some of those resources, please check us out at the website. Those things will not be on the website till probably Friday. They'll be available.
We're new to the whole website development thing, so it is a pretty bare bones site right now, but we will be building it and offering things to you for free all the time. So we'll get that going. That's also
an option. And we can connect just to some wisdom teachers who are really into the kind of things we just talked about. If that interests you, we hope you'll join us, but we'll offer you some information. Feel free to connect with us through the website too. You can leave questions there.
All right.
Hey guys, thank you so very, very much. In fact, it is so fun to see you do this. I actually get great joy in watching you impact so many different people that I care for and love so much. So it's fun to see. And I, as I've been sitting here listening, and I've written 2 pages of notes in my journal, and it's great stuff. So thank you for always sharing your truth, your honesty, your awareness to life. And gosh, I wrote down those words: consciousness, awareness, mindfulness. I mean, just actually, not walking through life so numb and so oblivious. And boy, I sure love that comment page about that you have 2 eyes that are always looking on to outside of you. But it's time for some of us. We have a tagline in the company. We say that we work from the inside out. And it's something that we have said for years and years. And a lot of people don't like that. They're like, wait, I need more leads. Wait, I need more of this. Wait, I need another technology. Yeah. And the hardest work, as we all know, will be done within ourselves. But then what's so interesting to me and so fascinating and amazing and cool and exciting is that the more that you work on the inside, the more conscious, aware, mindful, and finding that center or how you're able to hold on to yourself, it's like everything else comes together. And real estate becomes a very easy process because of who you've become in the process. So it's an exciting time. Just say, will you double check? Go ahead, say it then.
Well, when we love better, we serve better. That's how it works. And when you come from a conscious place, it's hard to be involved with hate. Hate is an unconscious act. I've hated. I was unconscious. I've loved. Now is a conscious choice.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't know how long ago it was. People would say to me, like, what are you doing? Like, why are you doing what you're doing? And I will look at them and I'll say, I'm just trying to figure out how I want to live my life.
Awesome.
And for some reason, I wrote this question down and I've said it before, which is, if no one told you how to live, if no one told you the beliefs you're supposed to have, if no one told you how you're supposed to do things, how would you do them?
Yes.
Right. How would you do them? How would you love?
You would do them originally and authentically. The real you would show up, wouldn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's why I often say, guys, as I say, you don't have to go to work. You get to go to work. You don't have to love someone. You get to choose to love someone. You don't have to, go make phone calls or go knock on doors or learn a script or, master something in the business of real estate or there's nothing you have to do.
Right.
And once all of a sudden you begin to realize that these are choices, and even though they're difficult ones to work from the inside out, as you guys have expressed so eloquently and so well, it becomes a whole different formula for a happy life. And it's a very peaceful place to be.
You know, George, it's so true. If you can just cultivate, really discover what is there inside of you, it's a process, and connect to it deeply, you truly become magnetic in your world. You know, you're just coming from a very real place, and that just emanates out, and you draw in all kinds of great things, including what you're experiencing in your immediate environment. So
yeah absolutely. Jennifer's making, you guys are gonna have to read all those notes in there. There's a lot of accolades for you guys. So just, you know, I was, Jennifer and I were talking this week, and I said, you know, it's interesting. You can often, you know, after 27 years of marriage, you can be attracted, you can love, and you can have an affection for many, many other different people on this earth. And somebody's like, oh no, there's only the one. I'm like, I don't know about that. But what I do know is that it's so much, you know, marriage or relationships, partnerships are far deeper than just, wait, do I love you? Or do I, you know, care for you? It's really comes down to a commitment, because there's many people in our lives that we'll come across that we love, we appreciate, we adore, we want to spend time with. And yet in our world, which is, you know, a complicated one, it seems like our focus points needs to be, what are we committed to? And maybe who are we committed to? But that's my own take on it. That's not necessarily yours.
Brilliant. I love it.
So
I love it.
It's good stuff. Okay. So with that, just will you guys double check that chat box? I'm just going to talk for just 2 minutes, but just if you'll double check that chat box. The reason I say double check it is Danette wanted to make sure that you put it, that she put the website in right.
Okay.
And great. So let's just make sure that's right for you guys. And then just with that, in closing, guys, Paige and Sharon are certainly available. They've got a great workshop workshops that they've put together. I hope that you'll take the time, the energy to want to develop that. The nice thing is no matter where you are, no matter what state you're living in, you have access to this and you have availability to that. With that, I remember several years ago, I was carrying around a pen. And in fact, it's not this pen, but it is a Mont Blanc. And those of you who can see this is a dear gift by actually a dear friend, Matt Salter. But he gave me this Mont Blanc. But I have another one that's a silver one and a black one. Well, these pens, give or take, cost around $500-$700. And I can remember holding this pen, and I handed it to my little Bella, who's now 13, but she probably was 10 or 11 years old. And I handed her the pen. I said, be careful with that. It's really expensive. And she said, well, Dad, how much is it? And I said, I think that pen, if I recall, was like $700. And she said, like many of you are probably saying, what? Why would you buy a $700 pen? And I remember distinctly, and I was looking back in my journals, and I said to her, the cost of this pen is relative in so many words to the fact of what you do with it. You can change the whole, what I said to her is, you can change the whole course of your life by what you write down. And I said, so this pen for me, or, you know, this journal or the many journals I have, is that they begin to shape and to develop and to create a life that is free, that's by design, that's based on our desires, based on what we truly want. And so whether that be the business of real estate, whether that be your relationship with yourself or your intimate partner, your children, your friends, your work, your community, your neighborhood, or maybe it's your health and your well-being mentally, physically, emotionally, and your well-being there. But any and all of those factors, the reality is you have the chance to change the whole course of your life. And oftentimes it starts with just pulling out a pen and writing. And I've found that over the years that the whole course of my life has changed in relationship to what I write down. And what has become relevant to me in my journal isn't so much that I'm sitting here as a historical record, but my journal has become more so a place where I'm able to ask myself questions. And so I just want to give you 5 questions. And I find it also ironic that yesterday, knowing I was going to speak on this, that also Danette Gramp, who is obviously our head of PR and marketing, just a wonderful, wonderful leader and lady. And as I was writing these things down again today, I thought, wow, how interesting it is that she was saying these same questions. And she had recently listened to something. So I just hope that you'll write these down And maybe Danette, if you could, I know you're there, but maybe you can write these five questions in this chat, and then we'll wrap up from here and go from there. But I just, they come from a combination of my own questions, and they come from the questions that got myself triggered in regards to Deepak Chopra. And I was, and I know that Danette was listening to something in regards to what he was sharing, but I just think they're very profound questions. And there's a few that I've added, I've tweaked, and I actually think there's an order to them that is important to me. Doesn't mean it's to you. You can put your own order, or maybe there's other questions you want to ask, but I just want to get you on the track of becoming more conscious, more mindful, more aware of what you want your life to become. And the one thing I've learned so deeply and profoundly from both Paige and Sharon is this one statement that, man, if I was to go get a tattoo, this just might be it. Live your life in the shape of your dreams, not in the shape of your fear. And so many of us live every day based on what we fear, what we're scared of. And we shape our lives in the shape of every negativity, every fearful thought or fearful approach to our lives. And the problem is that most of what we fear never happens anyway. We all know that. How many times do you get on an airplane, you think you're going to die because there's a little turbulence, but we're all here on this call to remind ourselves that you made it.
Right.
And that Delta Airlines will put that plane up in the air again, because in most cases, what you're thinking about rarely ever happens. So I just hope that you'll become more conscious, more aware of today, that you'll think more, that you'll take time to meditate, as Paige took us through that meditation. You'll take time and truly to become more conscious. So here's the five questions. I'm not going to elaborate on them because we're out of time, but here's the five. Number one, what am I grateful for? They talked about it. What am I grateful for? Man, that is the eliminator of all fear, to stay in a space of gratitude. What are you grateful for? What in regards to your feeling, to your actions, to your thoughts, to your emotion, feeling, experiencing gratitude, the eliminator, the antidote to all fear. Second question, who am I? Who are you? Are you just some skin and bones? Are you tissue? Who are you? What defines you? Who are you? Just come to know who you are. And one of the ways I found myself to understand who I am is to first declare who I am not. The process of elimination. Who am I not is what has helped me to come to understand who am I. Third question, what is my purpose? What are the reasons you're here? You got Paige and Sharon, right? And Dr. Cameron and others inviting you to participate, to elevate your consciousness and awareness, to elevate your relationships, your intimacy with yourself and others, to be more vulnerable. Man, those are big steps. Those are big invitations. I hope that you'll take them up on it. Fourth thing, what do I want? Simple question. What do I desire? What do I want? And look, whether it's something you want to buy, something to do, just get clear on where you're going. All poor decision-making comes based on the fact that you don't know where you're going. If you know where you're going, the decisions become easy. If you don't know where you're going and you're living in the shape of your fear, instead of the shape of your dreams, your goals, your aspirations, your most sacred desires, you're never going to achieve what you ultimately want to have or to become or to experience. So get clear on what you desire. Don't take it lightly. It's a critical component to all success. And then last, because I think this is a life, and I love what Paige and both Sharon talked about, but you're going to walk away with this thing from the pandemic and our current circumstances of humanity and culture, is you're either going to come out of this better, you're going to come out of it the same, or you're going to come out of it worse. So the question for number five for me is, what have I learned? What did you learn today? Don't ever let there be a day that you don't learn something. Expand your awareness and your consciousness to becoming more, or you know, coming to understand yourself more. And so often we're so committed to listening to what we listen to so we can listen to reply. How about we listen more importantly to understand? We're so quick to answer, so quick to reply. One of the things I've appreciated specifically with Sharon is that I'll be in meetings with her and she'll say something nice, or Jennifer will say something nice, and I'll just keep going and I'll keep talking. And she's always so good. Sharon's always said, hey, stop for a second. Did you hear what was just said? And I would, at that moment, I can tell you, I was listening to reply, not listening to understand. And I think there's something to be said with the way in which we learn that if we really want to learn more, boy, let's seek to understand before we have to have the privilege or gain the privilege or the desire to have people understand where we're coming from. But what's so cool is that once you understand where others are coming from, they're so excited to hear where you're coming from. But that takes a lot of emotional discipline to be able to do these types of things that I'm sharing. So with that, again, Paige, Sharon, Dr. Cameron, and all of the great agents and all of our great friends and affiliates and partners, thank you for being on today's summit. It was an extraordinary event. Get with Paige and Sharon, get with Dr. Cameron, improve your awareness and your consciousness to this life, because this is a beautiful life and it is a gift. And I hope that you recognize that and you honor yourself by recognizing that. So have a great day. Have a great week. Have a wonderful holiday season. Obviously, we'll talk soon. December 1st is our next Elevate. Hope that you'll be a part of it.